أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بفضل بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي علا في توحده ودنا في تفرده وجل في سلطانه وعظم في أركانه، فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى أهل بيته الغر الميامين المنتجبين. قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. Once again, we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for gracing us with this wonderful opportunity to continue to acquire the understanding of glorious Quran with the aim of enhancing our relationship with the glorious Quran. And in return, we are able to establish sound relationship with our beloved merciful creator. Last week, we began our discussion of this beautiful chapter by looking at some of the names or the names of this beautiful chapter. And you realize that last week, some of those names were as per the traditions of our beloved Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. We also looked at some of the virtues or merits, if you like, fada'il of reciting Surah al-Mulk. And then, of course, we ended our discussion by looking at the focuses of this beautiful chapter. We said this chapter discusses Usuluddin in three different ways, and we discussed them last week. Tonight, inshallah, we're going to continue with our discussion of this beautiful chapter. I received three questions from some of the participants last week, and I thought it's important I explain to ensure that we are all in the same wavelength. The first question is about the merits of reciting this beautiful chapter. So one of the mu'mineen sent me a question saying that I heard from one of the sheikhs that if you recite Surah Al-Mulk, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will make it easy for one in his grave during the arrival of Munkar wa Nakira. The answer is very simple, my dear brothers and sisters. You remember very well last week when we looked at the names of this beautiful chapter, we mentioned that one of the names is Mani'a. Simply means it protects a person, it saves a person from the punishment of grave. So long as the person who recites this chapter does not just recite it for the sake of reciting it, but reflect, you know, have some tadabbur over the verses of this beautiful chapter. And in addition to that, kindly allow me to share with you two other traditions from our beloved prophets, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. One tradition is from the Holy Prophet, that the Holy Prophet said, one of the chapters of glorious Quran, which is made up of 30 verses, whoever holds unto it, that chapter will become Shafi'ah for that person on the day of Qiyamah. In other words, if you hold unto Surah Al-Mulk, of course, with understanding, I keep repeating this, it will become intercessor and it will intervene on behalf of a person on the day of Qiyamah. And then the last tradition I would like to quote before we move forward is also a tradition from the Holy Prophet and Ibn Mas'ud, reported by Ibn Mas'ud, that the Holy Prophet mentioned when a mayyit is put in his or her grave, and then Munkar wa Nakir appear to that mayyit. As you know very well, the question of Munkar wa Nakir in grave is a fact, it's a reality, it will happen. We do have so many traditions, sunnatan wa shi'atan, when it comes to the question of Munkar wa Nakir. Even when we do our talqeen, when a person dies, we remember or we remind the person of the questions of Munkar wa Nakir. So the Holy Prophet, while explaining the merits or the fadila of holding unto Surah Al-Mulk, he said, when a mayyit is placed in his or her grave and Munkar wa Nakir come, they will first go and stand by the feet of that mayyit. And then they will start asking the question. Then a voice will come on behalf of that mayyit that this person used to make an effort to recite Surah Al-Mulk. Then the narration says, they will then move next to the tongue of that mayyit, around the head of the mayyit, and they will make attempts to ask mayyit a question. Then a voice will also come on behalf of that mayyit that this person used to use his or her tongue to recite Surah Al-Mulk. And then the tradition continues to say, then the Munkar wa Nakir will come and stand in the middle of the person, meaning around the body of the person. Again, a voice will come that this person used to recite Surah Al-Mulk fi laylihi wa naharihi, during his days and during his nights. So what we are trying to get here, my dear brothers and sisters, is that holding unto this chapter is something which is highly cherished by Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no doubt any other chapter of glorious Quran is of great essence and is of great importance. So that is for the merits which we discussed into details last week. Understanding the meanings is what will help us, you know, reap the benefits of this beautiful chapter in dunya and akhirah. Now let's go straight into the chapter. You know, mu'minin and mu'minat, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, out of his wisdom and love for our beloved Prophet and the ummah of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he revealed Quran to us. Quran really is as a result of Allah's love for the ummah. And this Quran, as you know, was revealed in batches. Some were revealed in Mecca and some were revealed in Medina, you know. Now, Surah Al-Mulk, in terms of order of revelation, was the 77th chapter of glorious Quran revealed unto our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And if you go into the sciences of glorious Quran, you will realize that Surah Al-Mulk, my dear brothers and sisters, I hope you are paying attention and taking some notes. It is a chapter which was revealed before Surah At-Tur, أو سورة تور. And then it was revealed, sorry, after سورة تور. Let me repeat again. سورة الملك is the 77th surah which was revealed to our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. And it was revealed after chapter 2 and before Surah Al-Haqqah. When you look at really the understanding of this chapter, you'll realize that it has a twin in glorious Quran. And the twin of this chapter is Surah Al-Mumtahina. You all, I'm sure, are lovers of glorious Quran. And I have no doubt in my mind that you are familiar with the names of the chapters of glorious Quran. If you are looking for the twin of Surah Al-Mulk in Quran, it is Surah Al-Mumtahina. Why? Because more or less, the two chapters are talking of the same. Talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Talking about the day of Qiyamah. Talking about Usuluddin, if you like, in general. So it is a very powerful chapter, without an iota of doubt. And of course, this chapter, if you look at the words used in this chapter, all the entire words of this chapter are 330. And then, of course, the letters used in this chapter are 1,300 letters. Now, what I would like to do now, my dear brothers and sisters, which is very, very important, it is the other question which I was asked by some of you, that I mentioned last week. This chapter, look at three major things, three major departments. So someone asked me a question. Can you share, please, break this department for us? So basically, my answer will be, we're going to do the tafsir of each and every verse. But nonetheless, I think it's important we answer this question to give mu'minin and mu'minat more ideas, more information about this beautiful chapter of glorious Quran. Now, if you look at this chapter, my dear brothers and sisters, as I mentioned, it's of three departments. Let them first analyze the first department and indicate to you which verses take care of what. And thereafter, inshallah, we will begin with the first verse. Tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulku wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. If you look at this chapter and you carefully examine the chapter, you will realize that verse 1 to verse 5, kindly pay attention. Verse 1 to verse 5 discuss Allah's power and authority over the universe. Hakimiyatuhu ala al-alam, the authority. وَمُلْكِيَّتُهُ, and the power of Allah over the universe. Verse 1 to 5. And if you are to break these five verses, you will realize that each one of these five verses are talking of something unique about Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's look at them. Verse number 1, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. I will come to the tafsir, don't worry. But take note of this. This verse number 1 discusses how each and every creature is connection to Allah. Not something that has connection. Kindly pay attention. I am connection to Allah. It's different from I have connection with Allah. When I say I have connection with Allah, it means what? I may have connection with him now, and I may not have it the next time or tomorrow. Meaning I may need him now, and I may not need him tomorrow. But when we say we are real connection to Allah, it simply means we will forever and ever be in need of Allah. Before coming to this world, while in this world, and on the day of Qiyamah. So first verse of Surah Al-Mulk highlights that all of us are real connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot do without Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It discusses mulkuhu, hakimiyatuhu, wa khuludu dhateh. This first verse discusses the Allah's absolute ownership of the universe and what is in it. It also discusses Allah's absolute authority over the universe. In addition, it discusses immortality of the essence of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We looked at the different sections of the attributes of Allah. We've got attribute of essence, sifatu dhat. What is attribute of essence? It simply means sifatuhu aynu dhati wa dhatuhu aynu sifati. His attributes are his essence, and his essence are his attributes. What does it mean? Attribute of Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Ar-Ra'uf, Al-Malik, isn't it? When we say his attributes are his essence, and his essence are his attributes, we are trying to say Ar-Rahman is Allah, and Allah is Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahim is Allah, and Allah is Ar-Rahim. Ar-Razzaq is Allah, and Allah is Ar-Razzaq. Different from I and you, isn't it? When I say Dr. Bilqis, she is a doctor, medical doctor, meaning she's got knowledge of medicine. But this knowledge of medicine is not Dr. Bilqis. And Dr. Bilqis is not the knowledge of medicine. There are two things here. Her knowledge of medicine and Dr. Bilqis. But when it comes to Allah, it's completely different. Why we are like that? Because if Dr. Bilqis do not continue to study and upgrade herself, she may tend to forget her knowledge, but Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, forever and ever, He is like that. He is like that before we came to this world, and He will remain to be like that. So, sifatuhu aynu dhati wa dhatuhu aynu sifati. Allah's essence are His attributes, and His attributes are His essence. If you go deep into philosophy, Allah's existence is His essence, and His essence is His existence. Allah's mahiyya is His inniyya, as they mention in philosophy. So therefore, the first verse discusses hakimiyyatul bari azza wa jal wa mulkuhu lillahi azza wa jal wa khuludu dhati. That's the first verse. And I will come to that, inshallah, when it comes to the tafsir. The second verse, my dear brothers and sisters, which is what? الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور. This second verse, what does it discuss? It discusses Allah's wisdom of creating life and death. When you look at life and you examine death, you realize that Allah is wise, is Hakim. So the second verse is teaching us the wisdom of Allah behind maut and hayat. And it discusses the essence of life, hadaf or faridish. Essence of life. Why are we here? What am I supposed to do here in this world? Why are we created? Some will tell you we're suffering so much. Hunger, issues. Why even am I here? We will look at it into details, inshallah, don't worry. خَلَكَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ. And if you look at the ayah, it mentions death and the life. Why? Because we are created for akhirah and not for dunya. Akhirah is permanent. Dunya is temporary. Imam Amir al-Mu'minin mentioned, إِنَّكَ خُلِقْتَ لِلْآخِرَةِ أو أنت مخلوق للآخرة لا للدنيا. You are created for آخرة and not دنيا. Then verse 3 to 5. These three verses discuss one thing. What does it discuss? The harmony between the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَّذِي خَلَكَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْكِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتٍ فَرُجِعِ الْبَصَرَ هَلْ تَرَى مِنْ فُطُورٍ ثُمَّ رُجِعِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ يَنْقَلِبُ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرَ So if you look at these three verses, discusses the harmony between the creations of Almighty Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, vis-a-vis the wisdom of the creation. So it's a very beautiful chapter, my dear brothers and my dear sisters. Now let's move forward. The second area of this chapter. Now we have discussed verse 1 to 5 and we have broken them into three. Verse 1, verse 2, and verse 3, 4, and 5. The second parts of this chapter are verse 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 14 verses. And these 14 verses can be broken into three categories. But if you bring all together, they are all hinting and highlighting on one thing. What is that thing? The effects of a belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the effects of that belief when it comes to our destiny. So all these 14 verses, whatever they are going to highlight, they are highlighting the rewards of one's belief in Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's take them one after the other. Verse 6 to 11. It teaches us, or it teaches us, the consequences of disobeying Allah and not believing in Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only that, verse 6 to 11 also highlights some of the reasons as to why some may not find it fancy to believe in Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then you come verse 12 alone. It stands on itself alone. It teaches us the reward of what? Of believing in the rububiyyah of Allah, in the lordship, in the mighty of our beloved merciful creator. In other words, verse 12 shed light on the benefits of believing in Allahu subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the last is verse 13 to 14, meaning two verses. What does it really teach? Or what do they teach, these two verses, my dear brothers and sisters? It teach us the importance of awakening in regards to believing in Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is important, to believe in Allah. It is important to connect with Allah. It is important to strive in finding Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Now let's go to the last part of this chapter, which is from verse 15 to verse 30. All these 15 verses, if you bring them together, they highlight one thing. And this one thing can be broken into so many segments. First, let's look at what the 15 verses teach us. The 15 verses provide us with an information on how Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala manages the universe and manages his creation. And it throws light on some of the signs of how Almighty Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala manages his creation, manages insan, manages universe, manages whatever he created. So it gives us signs of this. But now if you break these 15 verses into pieces, the first one will be verse 15, 16, 17, and 18. These verses, what do they highlight and what do they teach us? These verses teach us the importance of taking benefits from the blessings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then verse 19, stand on its own, tells us about birds and how birds fly. It's all signs of how Almighty Allah tabarak wa ta'ala manages this universe. And then the third one is verse 20, 21, and 22. What do they teach, my dear brothers and sisters? Allahu Akbar. It teach us Allah's support and Allah's favor over his servants, and how he loves his servants. And then if you look at the fourth one, which is verse 23 on its own, it also shed light on the power of the sense of hearing and the power of the sense of seeing and the power of intellect, which we'll discuss inshallah. And then if you go, the next line is what? Verse 24 to 27. What do they highlight and what do they teach us? These verses teach us the importance of embarking on a journey towards Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we will all be returned back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then of course, the last but one are verses 28 and 29. Shed light on the rahmah of Allah on the believers. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala always provide believers with his special and unique rahmah. Wa kana bil mu'minina rahima. And last but not least, before we begin with the tafsir of the first verse, which is verse 30, which is the last verse, it really highlights and teaches us the mercy of water which is provided to us by Allah and how water runs. These are all signs of how Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala manages this world. So this really, my dear brothers and sisters, are the areas that this beautiful verse discusses. Now let's begin with the first verse. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير. First, let's look at the term tabaraka. Please kindly pay attention, my dear brothers and sisters. This is not the only verse in glorious Quran where the term tabaraka is used by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. There are 8 places in Quran. I will share with you, take note of it, and you can refer to these verses later. There are 8 places in glorious Quran where the term tabaraka is used. The first one is this chapter. Chapter 67, verse 1. Tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. Our interest is the term tabaraka. The second area is in Surah Al-Furqan, Quran 25. But what is interesting is that in this chapter, chapter 25, 3 areas, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala use the term tabarak. The first one is verse number 1 of chapter 25. Tabarak alladhi nazzal al-furqana ala abdi liyakuna lil'alamina nadhira. Tabarak on the one who revealed the Furqan, which is Quran, on his servants to become a source of admonishing. In the same chapter, 25 verse 10, you will also have tabarak alladhi insha'a. So there is tabarak also used there. Not only that, in the same chapter, verse 61, tabarak alladhi ja'ala fi samai buruja. So there is tabarak. So in Surah Al-Furqan, you've got 3 places where the term tabaraka is used. That's 4. Let's go to the 5th place in Quran. Quran 55, verse 78. Tabaraka smu rabbika dhil jalali wal ikram. Chapter Rahman. That's the last verse of Surah Al-Rahman. Terminology, tabaraka, is used. Kindly pay attention. It's a very powerful terminology. And then another area, no doubt, my dear brothers and sisters, is Quran 40, verse 64. Fatabaraka Allahu Rabbul Alameen. Allah use tabaraka there also. Again, Quran 23, verse 14. Tabaraka Allahu Ahsanul Khaliqeen. Glory be to Allah, who is the best of all creatures. Now, these tabaraka have been used a lot in this glorious Quran. Question: what is the meaning of tabaraka? You see, tabarak, from the Arabic perspective, my dear brothers and sisters, is a rigid term. It's jamid. Rigid in what way? In the sense that it cannot be processed to be changed into different things like other terms. You know, sometimes you can change into past, you can change into present tense, you can change into future, you can change into amr, command, imperative. Tabaraka is a rigid term which cannot be processed, cannot be transformed into so many tenses. It cannot be transformed into active participle, ismu fa'il, or passive participle, ismu maf'ul, or amr, command, imperative. It is, my dear brothers and sisters, sifa lillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. It is attribute of Almighty Allahu Azza wa Jalla, this tabaraka. Yes, when you go to some Arab countries, you will find people naming their daughters tabaraka. And if you ask them, they will tell you, because you want to get the baraka of Allah for our children. But really, from the Islamic perspective, when it comes to the understanding of Tabaraka, it is exclusive for Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it cannot be used by anyone. It's like Allah, if you like. Now let's go further in trying to understand this Tabaraka. You see, Tabaraka, my dear brothers and sisters, is from the root of Baraka. Barakat. We all know the meaning of Barakat, meaning blessings. But just pause, wait for some moment. This Baraka is from Barak, on the scale of Tark. Ala wazni Tark, Barak. What does it mean? This Barak. It means camel's chest. Hence, Arabs sometimes will say Barak al-Ba'ir. When they say Barak al-Ba'ir, Ba'ir means camel. Meaning camel as place its chest on the ground, on the floor. And this term was later used to mean al-baqa wa dawam wa adam al-zawali, to mean permanence, survival, no perishing, to mean endless. So when it is used in Allah, tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulk, that tabaraka is highlighting that Allah is endless. No beginning, no end. That is why those who normally argue, or the critics of the proofs of cause and effect, when it comes to proving the existence of Allah. Because that proof says that لِكُلِّ عِلَّةٍ مَعْلُولٍ وَلِكُلِّ مَعْلُولٍ عِلَّةٍ, every cause has an effect and vice versa. So there are critics of this proof who are of the view that if every cause has an effect and vice versa, then who is the cause of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? Who created Allah? Philosophers will ask this question. But our simple answer to them is what? You've missed out something. Allah has no beginning. We have beginning. That is why we have cause. But Allah has no beginning. And since he has no beginning, you cannot ask of Allah's illa or Allah's illat. So tabaraka was later used to mean ad-dawamu wal-baqa'u wa adamu zawali, permanence, that's one. Survival, but survival not in a literal sense really. Survival in a true sense of survival. He will be there because he was there when there was nothing, and he will be there when there will be nothing. That's tabaraka. Wa adamu zawal, meaning everything will perish except him. Kullu man alayha fanil wa yabqa wajhu rabbika dhil jalali wal ikram. Every single thing on it, on earth, will perish or will perish except Allahu Jalla Jalaluhu. So the term tabaraka was later used to mean what? Al-Baqa, my dear brothers and my dear sisters. And not only that, if you go deeper into trying to understand this tabaraka, you realize that it is also used to mean containing something. Hence, Arabs, where water is contained, they will refer to that place as baraka or burqatul ma. Likewise, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he contains everything because he's got the capability of doing so, my dear brothers and my dear sisters. So really, come to the tafsir of this beautiful terminology used by Almighty Allah in glorious Quran, we find the following. And this following are as per the traditions of our beloved Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, alayhim afdal salati wa askas salam, as to the meanings of the term tabaraka. Allahu Akbar, tabaraka. Let's look at the first one. Tabaraka, ay ta'ala wa jalla, meaning Allah is mighty and he is exalted. Glory be to him. Tabarak. He is mighty. He is exalted. He is way higher than what you think, than all these limitations that you have. Tabarak. That's one. An Abi Muslimin, narrated by Abi Muslimin, that tabaraka, it means what? Al-thabitu, alladhi lam yazal wala yazal. Allahu Akbar. Said, it's the most established. Who will be there and continue to be there? Just one terminology we are discussing. Lam yazal wala yazalu. Meaning tabaraka simply refer to Allah as perpetual. He is perpetual. He is endless. وَقِيلَ مَعْنَاهُ تَعَاظَمَ بِالْحَقِّ مِنْ ثُبُوتِ الْأَشْيَاءِ بِهِ. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is great by the truth, and he is greater than whatever and whoever is in need of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some also got to a point of saying that when we talk of tabaraka, ma'anahu ta'ala, Allahu Akbar, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is the source of forever baraka. He is the source of kullil barakat, ever baraka and ever blessing. Allah is the source. And some scholars are of the view that tabaraka simply means barakatun kathira, a lot of baraka, a lot of blessings. That is also another meaning of the word tabaraka. And some got to a point of saying that when we talk of this tabaraka, tabaraka simply means what? Someone that no one will be able to do without him. This is the tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulk wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. Now, this is just the meaning of tabaraka. And you know, if you look at some of the tafasir of Quran, Allahumma tabatabari, for instance, Jawadi Amuli, Majma'ul Bayan of Allama Tabarasi. He said, you see this verse, the first verse, before we go, Alladhi biyadihi al-mulk, which inshallah will be next week. It gives us a very subtle reason. Ala anna dhat al-ilahi mubarakatun. That the essence of Allah is blessed. It gives you dalilun dimni, they call a very subtle reason, very silent reason. Tabarak. Just to tell you that Allah's essence, Allah's existence, Allah's hakimiyya, and Allah's malikiyya Amubaraka. Some say Tabaraka is an indication to Nama, growth, meaning Allah is a source of growth.
that whoever wants to achieve success with baraka, you have to hold unto him Allahu tabaraka wa ta'ala. So therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, we've spoken so much tonight. What we have covered before I open for your questions, we touched on some of the narrations again of the virtues of reciting this beautiful chapter. And then we look at the number of the chapter based on the order of revelation, which we mentioned 77, and how it was revealed, after which chapter and before which chapter. We'll look at the number of words, the number of letters in this chapter. And then we went into details, looking at different departments that this particular chapter takes care of. Thereafter, we began with the understanding of the term tabar, which is jamid, cannot be processed so much like the Arabs are able to process different letters, different words. But at the end of the day, tabaraka means what? Allah is the source of barakat. His that, his essence is barakah. His existence is barakah. He is the real barakah. Any other barakah is from Allah. Tabaraka wa ta'ala. Inshallah, God's willing, next week, we'll then look at Alladhi. Tabaraka, we'll look at Alladhi. Then biyadihi al-mulk. Why yet and mulk, hunt and mulk in this verse? Well, they are all for emphasis, but we'll discuss it. Then we'll look at wahuwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. Thereafter, inshallah, we'll go into the main interesting parts. And what, as I mentioned, you know, if you look at the whole chapter, there are two verses that are very famous. Very famous in this chapter. And these are verse number one and verse number two. They are very famous. And everything in this verse is built based on these two verses of this glorious Quran, or this glorious chapter. I'm happy now to answer your questions.
Alaykum
as-salam wa rahmatullah, Doc. Bismillah.
I have a couple of comments and one question.
No problem.
One is, thank you very much for that, because I never thought, I never looked at the word Tabarak in the light that you discussed today. Really beautiful, because it encompasses not only just one quality or one essence of Allah, but multiple attributes.
No. So
because it's Arabic form six, the verb is Tabarak, Arabic form six, which is a mutawi of Arabic verb form three.
Yeah.
So that means Allah is himself by himself, made himself by himself.
Absolutely.
So he's making himself. So it's not like, you know, we say bless you. So we are blessing somebody, but Allah is blessing himself. So he has made himself the blessed one. So that's beautiful. The second comment is, you know, when you mention Munkar and Nakir, every time somebody mentions Munkar, I just remember the 2019 Lady Fizza Quran competition. You know, when you have Murtada Ali Dina were considered Munkar and Nakir. And my question was, the first ayah, said it talks about connection. So I didn't quite understand what you said. You said it's not, we are not connected to Allah, we are connection. So do you mind just explaining that a bit more?
Yes, no problem. Thank you so much. I think what you've mentioned earlier on are also very beautiful. So Tabaraka, as we said, tanazzaha nafsahu bi nafsih, or takaddasa nafsahu bi nafsih, meaning Allah purify himself through himself. And Allah elevated himself through himself. That's beautiful. And then the second, your question is very, very valid question. So you see, we have two things here. It's either we are real connection to Allah, or we have connection with Allah. Let me use an example of us, Imam Dutch.
You know, I'm a real connection to Dr. Blakey. This is a philosophical, mystical term. No, no, I've got some connection, or I've got connection with Dr. Blakey. Two things. If I say I've got connection with Dr. Blakey, you know what? I may need her here, she may need me here. Oh no, you know, there are areas that really I can rely on her and she can help me. But if I say I'm a real connection to Dr. Blakey, means what? I can't do without her. There is no way I can do without her. I'm just stuck. Finish. I need her huduthan wabaqa'an. I need her at the inception and I need her for my sustenance until the end. So the same thing, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, there is istimrariyatun irtibat bihi. We've got this continuous connection to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala that forever and ever we need him. We cannot do without him. And there is no way that one can imagine. So therefore, if you recall, I mentioned, if you look at this first verse, it highlights really on three things. Hakimiyya, Malikiya and Khuludu Zati. That Hakimiya is Hakim, is the authority over everything. But this authority is absolute, so you need him. But more importantly, is Malik, ownership, absolute ownership. We need him. Big time. I can't imagine a day without Allah in our lives. And the Quran says, those in earth and those in heaven are all calling him. He is the one and only. So that was what I was trying to explain.
Thank you. Thank you,
Barakallah. Any other question? Do you have any other question before we make dua for our marhumin and those who are not well? Inshallah. It doesn't seem there is question, man. Today, some are fasting, so I think they, after breaking their fast, they couldn't gather the energy. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inspire us with the teachings of Quran and to make it easy for us. We pray that Allah forgive us our shortcomings and make us worthy of being his true slaves and servants. And may Allah illuminate our heart with Quran. And as I said, this chapter is a very powerful chapter, especially when we reach life and death. There are so many interesting discussions there, which I believe it will benefit all of us. Inshallah, let's hope and pray Allah accept us and accept our humble efforts and forgive all our mahumi and cure all those who are not well. We all have our hajat, my dear brothers and sisters. We pray that Allah fulfill our hajat. And we pray that things that are difficult for us in life, so long as they are legitimate, may Allah make them easy for us. And those that are easy for us, so long as they are legitimate, may Allah continue to make them easy for us. And I have a brother, you know, brother from another mother, a woman brother in America, Orlando, who's not been well. You know, he's been in the hospital for more than 3 months, Brother Ahmed. We pray that inshallah Allah cure him, it is cure, and Allah makes it easy for him, inshallah. I will see you next week, same time, it day. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-tahirin. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi. Remember us in your dua.